You're watching The Robert Christian Show.
And welcome, ladies and gentlemen, from wherever around the world that you are. I'm Robert Christian, your host for tonight's fiasco. We have a special guest with us tonight. We have Dan and Laura Dotson. No, we just have Dan Dotson from A&E's hit series Storage Wars. And, of course, we have our co-host Joey Shane. There he is, Mr. Joey. Hey, we were talking before the show about some things that maybe some parameters as to what we can actually talk about, what is open and what isn't on today's little event. However, oh boy, you know what? I didn't fix that screen. Okay. Anyway, for what it's worth, Dan, a good question, and I want to open up with this question because it's a good one. Yes, it is, from Hank. He writes in and he asks this question: for a typical week, what is a typical week for the life of American auctioneers? How many auctions are there in a typical week? Any certain times of the year that are busier than others? What do you think?
That's a great question. And, you know, we do a couple hundred auctions a week. And before the show, Laura and I used to drive like 250 miles a day, each one of us, right? We were putting 50,000 miles each one of our vehicles every year. Well, since the show, we're kind of together. So we have an A team of auctioneers and lock cutters and stuff that that we've put together. So they handle the majority of these 200 auctions a week. We usually, when we're filming, it's kind of different than when we're not filming. When we're filming, super busy. If we're not doing auctions, we're doing interviews. And normally what we do is most of the auctions that we film on Storage Wars are at AmericanAuctioneers.com. And we don't really broadcast which ones we're going to go to because we want it to be organic. So when I'm not doing auctions and I'm not doing that, we have a big piece of property that we bought about a year ago, and we've got an orchard, and there's a lot of chores and stuff to do around here. So Laura and I, you know, we stay pretty busy. We've got like five dogs, and we like to ride on the Harleys sometimes, and we've got quads and stuff, and we've got an RV, and that's kind of what we do. We just, we don't have time for big vacations. So, you know, we bought a couple of cabins 20, 30 miles from here in the National Forest. One's in Big Bear Lake and one's in Seven Oaks. And we will go there and just escape for a half a day or a night or whatever we can do. And we do a lot of that. We do a lot of charity work, so it's hard to get out of that. You know, a lot of nonprofits, they want us to do sales for them and stuff. And we try to give as much of our time as we can. And we charge for a lot of them too, most of them. But that's kind of what we do. I don't have much of a life. It's just auctions, really. Auctions and just kind of what we do around here. And we don't have a lot of time to do a lot of other stuff. But, you know, we'll take a little hike around the property and we'll jack with our dogs a little bit and, you know, ride and stuff like, you know, kind of normal stuff.
Well, I think it's interesting. You know, like I'd said earlier when I was in a conversation with you know, The Storage Wars, I've always been a fan of it. And I know that there are millions of, you know, am I crazy? But there's millions of other people just like me. Well, maybe not. God forbid if they're just like me. But they like the Storage Wars. And they like the New York bit. They like the L.A. bit. You know, and Dan, I've got to say that you are absolutely a hit when it comes to Storage Wars L.A. I mean, if anybody that can do it L.A. style, it's you.
Oh, I can do it any style, Robert. Really. I appreciate it. We appreciate, you know, everybody watching the show. We're in like 151 countries. It's like 31 languages, they say. And I understand we're in 300 million homes a week just in Latin America. And it's just amazing when you think of the magnitude that Storage Wars is around the globe. And one of the aftermath things that happened, the side results would be that a lot of families get together watching this show, and I just think it's fantastic. And I think as long as we keep creating really good shows and you keep watching, they're going to keep paying for them and making them, and so we're pretty excited about our future.
Well, if they don't, you know what? I think A&E would get a nice little letter from me. What's on your mind, Joy Shane? And hello.
Oh, hey, thanks. No, I just agree. You know, I enjoy watching the show. It's fun. It's comical at times. Most of the time, it's funny. I love how how fast Dan talks. It's amazing. You know, I got this slow Southern drawl, so I can't talk that fast. But I did have a question, though. You know, I know some shows that are live or reality TV, a lot of them are scripted. Is Storage Wars at all scripted?
Well, when you say, is Storage Wars at all scripted? Yeah, part of it is. I mean, we have interviews, and, you know, they'll say, hey, you know, today we're going to be going to, you know, Bakersfield or where the heck we're headed. Mm-hmm. And what do you know about that? And what do you think about that? So, you know, usually we'll come out with something like that, and they might kind of, you know, work with us a little bit to kind of make everything make sense. If, you know, if we go out to these are live events, they're public auctions, they're totally legitimate auctions. When
right.
you see that little red tag below that lock that we cut off for you guys, the lock isn't real. That's just for sparks, because sparks are cool. When sparks begin to fly, people begin to buy, and it's just fun to watch the sparks, because that's exactly the way that looked when we cut the lock 3 weeks ahead of time. But we don't just cut the lock and whatever. We have two people, one camera, tripod, and we videotape the whole process, because it's a legal process. And the people that lost it, they can pay it up at any time. Before I announce it's sold and collect the money on it, the people can pay their bill up. And so, you know, a lot of people say, oh, that's staged and whatever, because there's people out there that were suing. Everybody's saying, hey, I might have done this or that, but I don't know what they did. But I just know that my process is very legitimate. And as far as a scripted show, it's really not a scripted show like
right.
other shows. I mean, other shows have complete storylines, and ours just sort of evolves. You know, it's like, okay, we're all here to the auction. We've got 12 units to sell. Maybe the cast gets to buy half of them. The public buys the other half. The camera drops when the public buys it, but when the cast buys it, they just do a take two, and they just make it look like, you know, hey, it's just cast buying. So, you know, that part's all legitimate and real. And like I said, it's a legal process. So, you know, I'd have to say no. It's really not a scripted show.
That's awesome to know. Because, you know, like you had said, and I had said earlier, you know, a lot of shows are scripted that are supposed to be reality shows. And it's just good to watch a show that, you know isn't scripted. Has anyone ever come up, like, right before auction began and paid their bill up, and you were unable to auction off that
oh, yeah.
locker?
It happens all the time, and it's happened during filming. Actually, if somebody comes up when we're filming a show and they've lost a unit, because people will come sometimes with cash because they want to bid on their own stuff. They might not have the $1,000 to get it out of Hawk, but it is a public auction, and if they have cash and they're abiding by the terms, most facilities see it as commercially reasonable to make it a public auction where anybody can come. So therefore, they can come in and buy their stuff. That happens, and it happens sometimes when we're filming. But what the production company does is they just won't film that one at all. They will drop all the cameras. I will sell it to either them or somebody else, work out the deal. If the previous owner doesn't get it bought at auction, then I'll normally take their phone number and their name and the unit number. I'll give it to the buyer, and I'll say, hey, you know, this guy's got a certain amount of money in his pocket, and he's just really wanting to buy his toolbox back or his clothes back or something that you could probably normally sell for something. That kind of stuff they might purchase that back. As far as photographs and social security numbers and, you know, things that are sensitive, those things are just given back. Those are supposed to be given back. That's part of our terms. That if you're a winner and you buy a unit and you get all this personal stuff like that, then you'll put it in a box, and you'll put the unit number on the box, and you'll give it to the management. And that's how it works.
Well,
that's awesome to know.
Dan, what, you know, in your career, what has been the most expensive, the most elaborate, just all-out locker that you've ever sold?
Well, we have a unit coming up next week on Storage Wars, and it wasn't the most expensive unit I've sold in the last 20 years, but it was the most expensive unit that I've probably sold in the last 7 or 8 years. And it is a fantastic deal, and it's one of my clients, and we did the inventory on it. And, you know, it's a clean, nice deal, and somebody from the show bought it, and it was during a taping. So, let's just go back to the one 20 years ago. A unit, I think we got $18,000 for it, and it was full of Capodimonte, sealed boxes and Rococo style furniture. And it was a huge unit, and it was in Koreatown in LA. I just kind of, normally we just do these from the door the same way as the show, but this particular deal was just kind of special. So I took the 10 or 12 people that were at the auction at the time, I took them in the unit, can't touch anything, but then I pointed at somebody like, hey, Joey, would you pick out a box? And Joey would say, okay, that box right there. So I would take that box, open it. Well, I did that with four or five of the buyers, and it was all Capodimonte stuff. Anyway, I brought 18 grand in. And I think the guy that bought it, his name was Bob Camp. He died about a decade ago. I think he said he broke even on that one. And that was probably the most expensive unit, most valuable unit. I don't think that was your question, but that would probably be the Alberto Vargas stuff. There's a couple million dollars worth of stuff in that. Sold some years ago. Yeah.
What's the most bizarre?
You mean besides like a dead guy?
Oh, well, let's hear about that.
That's probably the most bizarre thing. I sold a Toyota car to the lady one time. This lady named, we'll just call her Maria B. because I don't want to say her last name. And I called her up the night before the sale, and this has been 10 or 11, 12 years ago. And I said, Maria, I've got the title to your car. And if you want to come to this auction tomorrow, which let's just say it's between Riverside and LA, if you want to come to the sale tomorrow, then I'll give you your paperwork. Well, I was there and I opened up this little 5x5, and the regular buyers were there, and there was just a few boxes and some stuff in this unit, a very small unit. And I'm looking for 20 bucks, and nobody wants to give me 20. And this lady, Maria B., she comes up, she goes, 20, I'll give you 20. So she pays 20 bucks for it. And instead of just hauling away that little bit of stuff that day, she decided to come back the next day because you have 24 hours. So when she came back the next day, there had been a conversation, a voice message left at the management company, at the operator's place, that said, hey, there's a box in the back of this, and whoever buys it, have them call me at this number because I want to come and get my personal stuff. This lady also jumped the fence, and she wrote a letter out by hand that said, hey, whoever buys this, there's a box back here, I'll come and pick it up. You know, don't look in it, basically. And so she shows up the next day, and she's got an 18-year-old son with her, and they talk to the manager, they're all excited, and then they open the unit up, and there's that letter that had been stuffed under the door, and now they're really excited because there must be bearer bonds, there must be cash, there must be jewelry, there must be something very valuable in this box for somebody to go through so much trouble to try to get back. She could have just paid her $25 monthly fee. She didn't do that. And so anyway, her 18-year-old son, she pulls the box out and opens it up, and she notices that it's plastic, and it's all kind of like duct taped up, and it's a 4-foot box by 2 foot by 2 foot. And I guess she's not fast enough for her 18-year-old son, because she's trying to pull through this duct tape. He pulls his pocket knife out, he slices it open, sticks his hand in this bag, there was a dead guy in there. She'd killed him 3 years before that and put him with lime and potting soil in plastic and duct tape and folded him up in this box. And now this 18-year-old kid got to discover it because now he's got his arm in it, and now the fumes are coming out. And that was terrible. And, I never could sell her another unit after that. Matter of fact, it took her about 8 years just to come back and get her 20 bucks. It was a few years ago.
Hey, Dan, on a bit of a different note, Jane Chapman from Facebook, see, I'm reading Facebook, says, Dan, I think that you and Laura are amazing. You are the main reason that I watch Storage Wars. Keep up the good work, Team Dodson.
Wow. Thank you, Jane. You know, I do recognize Jane Chapman and Hank Pabst. Shout-outs to both of you. Yeah, Jane's a big fan of the show, and I appreciate it. You know, I love the Twitter, and we've got, I don't know, tens of thousands of people that follow us on Twitter, and it's Auction Guy Dan and Pay the Lady Laura and Jay. Jane is certainly one of them, and I try to put my information out there, and I try to keep, you know, current stuff, and I've got a lot of master retweeters like Jane that help spread the word, and thank you for that.
And, well, you know what, I tell you, Dan, you've got a lot of fans. If I had as many fans as you do, I mean, come on. Hey, I'd be doing all right, Dan.
Jane, would you follow Robert and Joey, please? There you go. You got one more.
Oh, geez. Well, I don't know if she might say, "Oh no, I'm not gonna follow them." Oh no, these guys are two knuckleheads. But you were talking about really bizarre events at Storage Wars. What's one of the best days that you've ever had, Dan?
Best days, like period?
Yes.
Okay. About
most memorable.
About 21 years ago, I was at this auction. And it was in LA, and we were selling restaurant equipment. And I'm working the ground, and my friends are the Weiler Group. They're still in business. I worked with them for about 15 years, and we're selling restaurant equipment. And I looked in the door, and walks in this blonde-haired, green-eyed, beautiful woman. I remember like yesterday, and I am just amazed by her. I'm so amazed by her that I'm just blasting on her, you know, like, we're working the ground, and I got 2,000. What about 25? What about 5? What about 25? Oh, look at that green-eyed, blonde-haired kitty. You and I look good together, or dance, or whatever you want to do. And I did that, and she left. And then a year later, same auction, this same blonde-haired, green-eyed gal came in, and I did the same thing, and she left. The third year, this blonde-haired, green-eyed beauty came into the auction again, and I was just afraid she was going to leave, so I just took a break, and I gave her my phone number, and I said, you know, I'd just snatch you up if you're not attached, and she wasn't, and that was Pay the Lady Laura. So the most memorable auction I ever had was meeting my wife, probably.
That's so sweet, man. That's awesome.
I met my first wife at auction, too, but that was a pig auction, and it didn't work out so well. I'm just saying. I don't think there's any relevance there, but...
Well, you know what? Joey Shane and I both, and it was everything, Dan, everything that I could do not to say it prior to the show, but we've both been practicing our auctioneer.
Well, I would love to hear it.
And Joey, he's got a dandy one.
Yeah, I'm going to put you to shame.
Just put me to shame.
You know what? Joey Shane, he says, look, more or less, hey, I need a job. I want a job. Maybe, well, who knows? Maybe Joey can be an auctioneer. I don't know.
I think I got what it takes.
But Joey's got this auctioneer thing. Go ahead, Joey.
All right. Here we go. This is how we do it in North Carolina. Ready? You ready for it?
Yeah,
here
go ahead.
All right. Can I get a dollar? Can I get a dollar 50? Can I get $2? Can I get 250? 250 going once. 250 going twice. Sold for 250. Don't forget to pay the lady.
That's not bad.
See?
That's bad. It's not how fast you go, Joey. It's how well of a communicator you are. And I would say that was very clear and precise and right on.
Charisma, man. I got it.
You do have some of it.
I got something.
No, you do. I would say you've got a good basic building blocks there to be an excellent auctioneer. Robert, are you an auctioneer also?
Oh, yeah. He's amazing. He's awesome.
No, I'm not. You know what? I told you the story, Dan, back when I was in school. Robert. Oh, I will just a sec.
He has to tell the story first.
Yeah.
That's his style.
My speech teacher, she said, look, if you all pass the semester, pass the thing, I'll teach you all to learn how to talk like an auctioneer. I was like, oh my God, that's what I wanted. But I forgot it. So I just come up with some crap and I said, you know, hey, this has got to work.
Let's hear it.
Oh my God! You know, he got an A. I'm probably gonna get a D.
He didn't get an A.
No, he didn't get an A.
But it was like a high B. We have to leave room for improvement.
I'll take it.
Mine is sort of like now Stevie's gonna be there. The room, he's gonna be laughing his butt off. I could just see it. Oh my God! Then I'd be sitting there, you know, like I'm gonna sell a coffee mug. You know, I showed you the coffee mug. I'll be like, $100 here, $100 there. Gotta get $100. And Joey is laughing. You know, I don't know how to. Oh, and don't forget to pay the lady. You know, for the life of me, I forgot how to do it.
I believe that.
See, I got a D. I told you I got a D. Folks that are watching the live show or the podcast or YouTube, hello YouTube, we love you. We have a good teacher here, but he's got a really poor student. Go ahead, Dan.
Well, no, I'm just thinking that you know, the difference is between your guys' style. If I was just trying to give an objective opinion, I would say that Joey Shane was very clear with what he wanted. And he was very clear with where he was at and what he was looking for. And so, therefore, you know, he may have been slow and methodical, but he might have been effective. Robert Christian, you had a lot of swag going there. I mean, it sounded great, but it just didn't make a lot of sense. I mean,
well, it never does.
Well, it's supposed to.
Okay, now let's hear a pro do it.
Well, if I was just to do it just regular, I might say, well, I've got a dollar here, and who'll give me $2 where? I've got one here, now two where, now two, now two. What about two, now two? What about $2? How about that? What about $2? What about two, now two? How about a buck and a half? I got a buck. What about $1.50 going once? I got a dollar bill and a $1.50, and what about $1.50 going twice? Got to go guess what? $1.75, $2, $2.50, $3. Got to go guess what? $9. So let you wait for $2.50, itty bitty cents, and thank you. Good night, fine, bad, that's great. You tell a friend to sell it to you. That'd be Dan Dotson, American Auctioneers. And don't forget to pay the lady.
You know what? Actually, Dan, I've never seen a storage war where you've said, don't forget to pay the lady. It's Laura that says it.
Well, you keep watching because...
You need to take the helm and say, pay the lady.
Well, no, because I'm really not the lady. So I would probably say something more like, pay the Dan. Don't forget to pay the Dan. That's probably what I would say.
You know, I think it's amazing. Like I say, you know, my swagger, oh Lord. And you, do you have any idea? My hands are sweating, like, you know. Thanks a lot, Joy Shane.
Yeah, you were red. That's why I wanted to do it, because you were red.
You did great. You should keep stepping out of your box like that, Robert, because that's what's going to make you go to great heights in life, stepping out of the box.
You know, sure. I have to, Dan. I've got to look out of the box. And, you know, with my interview with you, what I really want to do of anything is to give the podcast listeners, to give those on Facebook, those on Twitter, everybody, to let them know and to hear something new about you that maybe that you don't say on the shows.
All right.
But where they can know you better as a person and really what makes you... What makes your gears grind?
I mean, I have some passions in my life. I used to, you know, when I was a kid, I used to do this Kempo karate stuff. And I was raised in this neighborhood. It was a brand new neighborhood. And there was 48 homes. And there was two white families. And there was three Hispanic families. And then there was about 43 black families, and it all kind of went low income. And so I moved in that neighborhood when I was 9, and I fought all the downtime until I was like 16. The other day, somebody reaches out on Facebook and they said, I remember Dan Dotson used to talk about Bruce Lee all the time, and his name was Martin Thomas. And so I replied back, I said, is this Marty Thomas? And he said, yes. And I said, then I, you know, communicated back, and I said, do you remember that one time that we got our asses kicked in that field and they chased us out with rocks all the way out of this field, and I got home and I told my folks that I ran, and they just went crazy on me. You can never run again. And that's almost cost me my life a couple times in my life, because I'm not really good at running from anything, and I just can't hardly do it. And when it comes to flight or fight, I just don't run, you know, so we're gonna have to work it out. And so anyway, he come back and he goes, God, I'm amazed you remember that. Yeah, that was a bad neighborhood. My family moved us out of there immediately. We went to Claremont. I'm thinking, you bastard, you left me there alone until I was 16. But, you know, so in the mid-90s, I started doing this Kung Fu Sansu. And I actually got a black belt in 96 or 97. And I kept working out with this Kung Fu Sansu until my mom passed away in the year 2000. And I just never went back. And I'm still friends with him. And it's kind of like a family. But, you know, I used to train a lot. And, you know, I'm good with double swords and short sticks and a staff. And I just, I've been thinking about maybe getting back into that. And I'm kind of a bigger boy now, so I would probably need to lose me 30 or 40 pounds. But you do that in a minute, you know, working out. And that's one thing about me that people, you know, they don't know.
Well, I would imagine you meet some very interesting people, to say the least, doing what you do. But do you do anything for animal shelters, for an example, you know, humanitarian type efforts?
Well, I have done stuff with animals and stuff, but most of the I do most stuff for, you know, kids or the cancer research. I have dozens and dozens of charities that I work with every year, and we raise money and stuff. As far as animals, probably the closest thing I get is probably not really politically correct, but I do a lot of stuff with Safari Club International and Rocky Mountain Elks and Ducks Unlimited and a lot of hunting and sporting groups that raise money for, you know, habitat and stuff. So, I mean, I've raised millions of dollars for that. I've raised tens of millions of dollars for a lot of things. And, you know, everything from people that go around the country and straighten out spines to, you know, the Curet Foundation. They raise money, you know, to do research on cancer and stuff. And those are some of the ones that are kind of close to me, you know. But the Diabetes American Heart Association, I've done a lot. I've done hundreds and hundreds of fundraiser auctions for that many groups over the last 40 years.
What makes you keep doing them? I mean, I think it's wonderful that you do, but, you know, a lot of celebrities, unfortunately, or a lot of people, as soon as they reach that celebrity status in life, as it were, they want to forget the little guys. You don't seem to do that.
I'm going to put my wings back in my shirt now, because I do several things for free every year, but I charge for a lot of stuff. I mean, I'm an auctioneer, and that's how I'm wired. I'm wired to make money, and, you know, for decades and decades, I charge $300-$500, $1,000 to do auctions, and now people pay me $10,000 to come to do an auction, or $2,500, or $5,000, or whatever. And, you know, it's just I get a lot of requests to do a lot of sales, and I've got several auctioneers that are underneath me that do fundraiser work, and we sell them to people, you know, and, you know, because that's how we pay the bills. But you know, I don't know. I try not to forget the little guy, and I know that, you know, we have to give back. God's given us a big blessing with this show and everything, and I'm not sure what he has planned for me, but it's something. And so every opportunity I can do to give back, I do. And I have a lot of, like I said, nonprofits that get a hold of me all the time, and a lot of them, they just don't have any money. And if they don't, and they're close, and I can work it into my very busy schedule, then I will work it out. And so, I mean, I'm not an angel. I just, I try to help as many people as I can. But if I helped everybody that asked me, I wouldn't have time for anything. I mean, I would be burned out.
Well, absolutely. You know, of course, you've got to be able to make money doing what you do, but you got to have fun doing it too. Else, why would you keep doing it?
You know, my grandfather always said, my grandfather taught me to auctioneer in 74, and he always said, you know, Danny, if you will have a good time at this, you will be one of the best auctioneers anywhere. And so I've always just had a good time. I enjoy auctions. It's like a passion for me. And I love getting people together and, you know, and getting their money, giving them something that they want. And it just makes me feel good. And I like the attention. And you know, and it's just always been my passion.
Forever. Do you think that maybe your grandfather would be proud of you today?
Oh, yeah. You know, he used to come out here to California, and I'd go back to Arkansas when I was an older guy. And I'd do auctions, like, in my 20s and early 30s. And, you know, he was getting older, and, you know, but he would, you know, he would see where I was failing at, maybe where I'm missing bids and stuff. And he would always come up, you know, I would always hear him out there, oh, you got one over here, you got one over there. And finally, I was 30, mid-30s, and he came up to me at an auction. And he goes, you know, Danny, he goes, you are a better auctioneer than I ever was. And that was probably the hugest compliment that anybody in the world could give me. And he'd already given me the best gift that anybody could give me in the world. And he gave me my livelihood. You talk about giving a guy a fishing pole, man. He gave me a huge net and a boat and everything, you know. Oh,
well, yeah. Tell us about Laura, how she became an auctioneer, and what was behind her driving force that really impacted her life, where she decided that that's what she wanted to do.
Well, I taught her how to auctioneer when we first met. I I've had two wives, and I taught them both how to auctioneer. And, you know, I just kind of, I like everybody around me to be an auctioneer. Kids, nephews, nieces, whoever it is, if they have an interest, I want them to do it. And Laura and I had been together, you know, a couple years or whatever, and she was kind of an auctioneer, just practicing the car. And I got all four of my wisdom teeth out at one time. And I couldn't even talk. And I went to her with my mouth this big, and I said, and she goes, what? I said, I'm telling her, you have to go do this auction. So what does she do? She runs to my mom, which was an auctioneer also. And she tells my mom, oh, he's had all his wisdom. He can't do this, and you're going to have to go do this auction. And my mom was 4'10", and she looked at her, and she goes, no, young lady, you're his wife. She wasn't at the time, but, you know, whatever. You're his wife, and you were going to go do this auction. And so Laura had to go do it, and she came back, and she had done really excellent. And she's a big people person. She's very social, and she's very smart. She's got a big old IQ, and you know, she speaks like five languages, and she's really good at getting along. You know, she's just very smart, and so it kind of really came natural to her. And I couldn't be prouder of her being an auctioneer. I think she just does it, not necessarily because she's got a big passion for it, but we have a lot of auction work around, and she is asked to do it all the time. So why not? Why shouldn't she be able to do it? I mean, I'll just have to pay another auctioneer to go do it. Why not have her go make that money and pay some of these bills that she's helped create?
Well, I mean, I don't know about you and Laura, you know, off camera, off the show, and at home, but I can tell you about Joy and I, because we spend more time during the week talking about the shows and getting things lined up than what you could shake a stick at, really. Joy, he's great. I love him. He's been a very active part of the show for about the last, 8 months now. But so literally we take the show to bed with us at night. We wake up with it in the morning. You know, that it just is so...
No wonder it's a mess, Robert.
I'm telling you, Dan. But do you and Laura do the same thing?
You know, our life comes at us so fast, we just sort of have to handle things as they come. We don't get a lot of time to kind of prep and say, well, you know, it's going to come... It's like this show. I mean, what am I supposed to do? I don't know who's going to ask me what. I just better be prepared and know what I'm talking about. So with our life, we know that we have, you know, when we have auctions, we know we have so many auctions. If we have an interview, or we have a fundraiser, or we have a trip, or we have filming, or we have interviews, whatever it is, I mean, we have people around that help remind us what our schedule is, and then we just go do it. We're more reactionary, I think, than planners. We're not huge planners. I do have plans, and we do have big dreams, and we have things that we work on constantly that, you know, are long-term goals for us, and, you know, We work on stuff. We bought a lot of rental properties and stuff. The first couple of years of the show, we didn't spend any money. I saved every nickel. And then we decided, you know, we need to buy, you know, duplexes and houses, and we need to fix them up, and we need to rent them out. So that's what we did in our own local community, is we bought, you know, duplexes and houses, and I had a crew busy for a year and a half fixing them all up, and you know, so it's part of our retirement. And that's, Laura and I have fun doing stuff like that. Okay, we need a kitchen. Okay, what kind of tile? What kind of cabinets? What kind of granite do we want to put in this thing? And, you know, she's really good at, with her eye and designing stuff. So, you know, she's very particular about how she wants stuff. And me, I just kind of schlep through everything. And, you know, so it's a kind of an interesting dynamic with us.
Yeah, absolutely. Oh, and before I forget, I don't want to be rude, but I do want to thank John Luke from New York for his help. He's been tweeting out pretty regularly today about the show, the interview tonight with you, Dan. Hey, you know what? I think he might be one of your fans.
Actually, I'm one of John Luke's fans. He's the ringleader from New York Storage Wars. He kind of holds up the East Coast of things, and I kind of work on stuff here at the West Coast. And my hat's off to John Luke. I thought he did a great job on Storage Wars New York. I think he's a very unique individual. He certainly knows where all the food places are, like, you know, in his areas. And, you know, I always thought he's very interesting to watch and listen to. So, yeah, I consider John Luke a friend, and I've never met him, but we've actually done business together. And, you know, if he has something, you know, he had a deal up in San Francisco one time, and I sent a crew up there and did it. And, you know, we just kind of worked it out. I do that with a lot of auctioneers around. But John Luke's cool.
You haven't gone to New York, though, right, to do an auction there?
No. No, I say that with hesitation, because you know, I've been there for a lot of promotions, and we go there, you know, we've been there the last several years for Upfront New York, and I was trapped in the Trump Tower for 7 days. What was that big-ass hurricane a couple years ago?
Oh, yeah. Sandy, Hurricane Sandy.
Yep, I was in Hurricane Sandy. Miss Laura and I were there, and we were stuck for 7 days. They couldn't get us out of town quick enough, so everything got closed down. So I went up and down through the Trump Tower, and I collected every little fruit basket and every bottle of water I could find. I could have lived in the Trump Tower for 6 months. I had everything.
Well, did you have you ever met Donald?
Trump?
Yes.
No. No.
You never did, really? I'm. That's kind of shocking.
Well, you know, he's a busy man.
Well, he is, but you know, he always makes time, I think, to meet people that he really wants to meet. And I would have no problem, Dan, meeting your wife.
Hey, you're invited anytime. I'm a lot easier probably to get a hold of than Donald Trump. You know, but you know, my machine's not quite as big as Donald Trump's, and I'm probably not you know, as busy working things out. I mean, he's got his own life and his own problems, I'm sure, that are probably make my problems look just that big. And so, I mean, I don't want to trade no shoes. Plus, I got better hair.
Now, Andrew in a chat is attempting to ask a question. Have you ever considered online something? I think that you could do quite well with it.
Escort service.
escort service. Oh, no, no, no. You know, hey, it's no secret. If I was on the sidewalk with a for sale sign around my neck, you know, I bet there wouldn't be anybody that'd buy me.
Well, you'd have to make that sign out of plexiglass.
He repeated the question. Is Dan, have you considered online auctions? I think you could do very well, quite frankly. Your name is worth money alone, I'd imagine.
Thank you very much. And yes, we have been working on a live online dual auction process for this. Thanks for asking this question. For the self-storage facility for the last 8 months, Laura and I, we co-founded this company that I'm not even going to say their name because they're not even worth it, but we own part of it, right? And they got like 700,000 people that started, you know, getting involved trying to find auctions and stuff. Well, then this company merged with another company that's online only auctions, which means you don't have a live auctioneer, you don't have a live preview. That means you have to buy everything off a videotape or a photo, and that's just not very cool. And that's really not fair to anybody. I don't think it's commercially reasonable. So yes, we are very close to putting together a live online dual process for the self-storage industry. You can go to AmericanAuctioneers.com. You can sign up right now, it's free. And it won't be free once it comes along, but we are absolutely trying to put something to the industry that the industry will benefit from. And you know, right now you've got a bunch of programmers out there that got all excited because of Storage Wars and this revolution with buyers, and they're on the train thinking, oh, we can make it easy, we'll just let them look at a photo or a video and we'll let them bid on it, and hopefully everything will turn out. And you know, believe it or not, these companies are really growing. They're growing fast, and the industry really likes it because it's less work for them. But I think, you know, in New York, there's a big lawsuit that states, you know, online-only auctions are illegal. So I don't want to do that. I want to do a live auction, and I just want to enhance it with the online. So that way our auctioneers will have an interface that, and any auctioneer in the country will be able to use this, and they can communicate with the people on the ground. They don't have to go through a third party.
Would that be similar to like what eBay is doing? I think that's the online auction place, isn't it? eBay?
eBay, I believe, used to have a live online dual process where they would do both, but I think they got away from that a long time ago. And I might be wrong, but you know, companies like ProxyBid, Live Auctioneers, they are a third party that will charge you 5% and $500 to put together an online auction for you. And you can do a simultaneous auction, but it's very expensive. So I want to find a way. You know, storage auctions, an auction makes $200-$400 on each one. Sometimes we make more. So the secret is to pile up a lot of auctions during the day. You know, if we have 5 to 20 auctions a day, then that's perfect. And if we can do a live auction and again enhance it with an online process and online participation, then I think that would be the best of both worlds, not only for the industry, but it'd be best for the buyers. because I do warn all the buyers out there that are, if you're buying online only auctions right now and it's a timed auction, then you're sacrificing your personal inspection. That means that if enough of you keep buying it that way, the whole industry will do it. And then you won't have no personal inspection. You won't be able to smell rat feces or cat pee or, you know, industrial solvents or gasoline. You're not going to be able to get a really great idea of what's in that unit because you really need a three-dimensional look. Video's not enough. A picture's either going to make something look better or it's going to make something look worse. And in the case where it makes something look worse, then that's not fair to the people that lost it. The people that lost the unit, when they get more money than what's owed, they're entitled to get that money back, all the overages. So if you're not doing your very best job at getting the best money for it, then you're doing a very injustice to the people that lost it. And those are the ones, my friends, that can do the biggest lawsuits against the industry and can cause them the most damage. Because if somebody loses something and they can prove that it commercially wasn't reasonable and it wasn't fair, and let's say there's tools in that unit or something that they use to make a living, then that's conversion, and they can go punitive damages and they can get whatever they want. If they would have made $60,000 a year, you know, maybe they would have done that for 5 years. There was 5 years worth of use left in that airless sprayer. I would have made, you know, $50,000. So, you know, you owe me blank amount. You owe me $300,000. And those are very real threats out there. And I'm just hoping that the industry really wakes up and they just don't go too fast, because, you know, online only auctions are like driving through the fog. You just never know what you're going to run into, so you should slow down. And so that's all I'm wanting the industry to do, is slow down. Give me about 60 or 90 days to throw this into the industry and auctioneers all over the United States and Canada. I want to unite all the auctioneers in the United States and Canada. I want to unite everyone, and I want every buyer to let their auctioneers know that there is a way to have a live and an online auction. That way, if you want to go to an auction and you want to bid online for another auction, you can. Or if you want to go to an auction and make sure they're being straight with you, you can bid online. You can turn your back to the auctioneer and you can bid, and you can see if he's being straight with everybody else that's there. And that's a good way, because, you know, there's a lot of room for fraud and stuff. And these are legal processes. These are very important. And in Babylon, 500 BC, that was where some of the earliest recorded auctions, and fathers used to actually sell their daughters at auction. And it was illegal to do it any other way. You had to sell them at auction. You know why? And I'm not saying it's cool to sell people, because it's not cool to sell people. But even 2,500 years ago, you know, people knew that to have a good, fair auction, you needed to have an oral auction in front of everybody, very transparent, not something hid behind a keyboard where a manager might talk to a potential buyer because they have a personal relationship, and maybe that manager will tell that buyer something, or maybe the manager takes the picture of the photos and maybe he doesn't take a good photo. Maybe there's something in the back that you can really see if you were there, but you can't see on a photo. Maybe that manager tells a buyer, hey, buy this one, I don't care what it brings, because there's something in this one. And then that person will just be a partner with the manager. Now you've got a dirty manager and a dirty facility and a dirty industry, and that's just not what we need.
That's absolutely right. Well, Dan, let me ask you this. Hank is watching on the YouTube channel, by the way. He asked the question about how many typical auctions in a week, and are there certain times of the year that are busier than others. You'd actually address that from the get-go. But another very good question for you is this, and thank you, writer. I don't know who actually wrote this, but the question is, are you planning on sticking with storage lockers, or would you later look at maybe auctioning off houses or automobiles or anything like that?
I'll answer that question. First, we're going to finish answering Hank's question. And I think one of them was, are there better times than other during the year where auction prices or, you know, goods are, and it is, it's a big wave. And it certainly seems like around April, everything kind of builds up to about April. And then then you get into May, and you know, August, September, it starts getting hot, the crowds start getting smaller, until about October it cools down, then the crowds go up and the prices go up. So between April and October is probably the cheapest time, at least on the West Coast, to buy your stuff. As far as do I want to sell other stuff besides self-storage, I have sold everything you could imagine under the sun. I've been doing this for 40 years, and I've done every type of estate. I've sold every kind of animal. I've sold any kind of equipment and cars. I've sold airplanes and helicopters. I've sold everything. And to answer your question, yes, I would like to expand our business into estates. And we do a lot of legal auctions and, you know, business liquidations. We'd like to expand on that because, you know, Storage Wars has made people pay their bills a little bit better. So there is kind of less inventory than there was before the show because more people are paying their bills. And so, yes, we've got a big company here. We've been around since 1983, and I don't want to go anywhere anytime soon. So, yes, any good business will expand, and I would like to expand into more estates, fine arts, maybe business liquidations, stuff like that.
Fantastic. All right, Joey, you got a question I see on the tip of your tongue.
Yeah, I was just going to add, well, I got like two questions that I can think of right now. First one would be, you know, are there any big things you and Miss Laura are working on right now? Any future endeavors you're going to take part in outside of the online auctioning and things like that? Anything like that?
Well, you know, we first moved into this big house about almost a year ago. And when we moved in, I got my first electric bill, and it was like over $4,000. And then the next month was like $36,000. And then the next month was like $3,800. And I'm just going crazy, right? I'm saying I would have never bought this big, beautiful house for my beautiful wife if I would have known that my electric bill was going to be $3,500, $4,000 a month. So we put in a 46 kilowatt 197 panel solar system. It's the biggest one in San Bernardino.
Yeah.
Biggest one in San Bernardino County, and we're producing about 300 kilowatts a day, and you know, it's 100 and something bucks, and I just very happy. You know, I changed my $3,600 bill into $1,850, and we're here in San Bernardino County. We have a thing called a HERO program, so they'll put it on your taxes for your home, and you just pay it once a year. And so I'm really excited about that. In addition to that, I moved here on the mountain, and I got my first water bill, and it was $1,300. And then my second water bill was $1,300. And then my third water bill was $1,300. And I thought, screw that. I'm going to drill a well. So that's what I did. I spent $43,000. I went down 750 feet. Now I'm getting 40 gallons a minute. And I'm getting my water basically for free now, as long as it lasts. And I just, you know, I tested it and everything, and I spent a lot of money to get the analysts on it. And I just got that today, just a couple hours ago, and I opened it up and I thought, what the hell is this? I don't understand any of this stuff. So now I have to find an analyst for my analyst.
You got to find someone to read the results.
Yeah, and understand them.
Yeah.
Have you ever auctioned off a green locker? In other words, one full of solar panels and all this living off the grid type of equipment?
No, probably green bud. You know, some of them with green cash and some of them with green bud and, you know, a lot of hyperphonic stuff. But as far as solar panels and stuff like that, I haven't seen any of them.
Well, did you give them a good deal on the whole locker full of green bud?
I believe the law would have been called on that one.
Exactly. You know, most of these things we never find out, and rarely we will find out after the fact. And, yeah, it's happened. There's been everything in storage units has sold. Everything.
Yeah, that's awesome. I don't know if it was during the show or before the show, you were talking about you had some cabins.
Yes.
I love cabins. Like, we do a lot of off-grid shows. It's one of my personal touches for the show. We do a lot of things about off-grid living and things like that. Solar energy, harvesting rainwater, preparedness, nice. All kinds of stuff. And I love cabins and things like that. It just kind of piqued my interest. What do you do to relax or a hobby or, you know, you, Dan the man, not Dan the auctioneer, but Dan the man not at work. What do you do to relax?
Dan the man's mostly at work. I mean, if, you know, things that I don't consider work, but they are work, is like the social media, you know, the Twitter and the Facebook. It takes a lot of time. And, you know, so Laura and I, we'll be sitting there, you know, we'll be sitting there side by side. She'll be on her phone. And we do that sometimes for hours. And that's just crazy. I think the most, the most relaxation that we get is driving. Laura and I like to drive because when you're driving, nobody recognizes you. I mean, they do when you're on the freeway, but not when you're on mountain roads and stuff. So, you know, Laura and I, as long as we can get off by ourselves and sneak away, we do a lot of that. And we'll just, you know, we'll go up there and, you know, we'll stay a half a day. We might have us a drink or two and watch a movie or whatever and look at the squirrels. And, you know, I like the woods. And that's how I do it. I used to do a lot of hunting and stuff, and you know, I like to get out in the wilderness, and I like to, you know, feel one with nature. I like to smell the smells, and I like my motorcycle for the same reason, because you can smell everything as you're going through, and you know, that kind of gives me the same kind of feeling when I've got a rifle in the woods when I'm riding my Harley. It's kind of the same. I know that sounds twisted, but it is.
Well, yeah. Hank has got another question. Can you ask Dan if the bears are behaving themselves?
You know, thank you, Hank. The bears have been behaving themselves. It's so funny. We've got about a 15-month-old 90-pound mastiff dog, and he's a big old juggle-headed dog, and we call him Rambo. And then we've got a couple other shepherd, and Laura's got a couple of small dogs that they listen to everything, and they alert us. And then when the big dogs are, anyway, this. My dog comes home one night, and he's got a hole under here, and he's got a couple of big scratches on his side, and I'm thinking he got into it with the coyotes. Well, the next morning he gets out, and he takes the little yellow shepherd with him, and then this lady calls me because his number's on the collar, and she goes, "Your dog's down here. Where are you at?" So I go down there. She goes, "I have to tell you this story. Yesterday I saw a bear come off your pergola, and this dog was right behind it. And where did they end up with all this? We have like 800-acre mountain. Where did they end up with all this room in my backyard? And your bear was like, your dog was ferocious, and the bear was ferocious, and they were just at each other. And what was in between them? A rattlesnake." I said, "No way." She goes, "Yes. I swear to God, I wish I had the photo." She goes, I turned around, I went inside, I called animal control. When animal control come, the bear was gone, your dog was gone, but the snake was still there, and they took it away. I swear to God, as I sit here, that's what she told me. So yes, Hank, the bears have been minding their P's and Q's. We haven't seen them, and hopefully we don't. 2 years ago, they said there was a bear and two cubs in the pool. They let them swim for a couple, 3 hours or whatever.
Back to John. Look, I'm reading Twitter. News Talk 2. You can follow me on Twitter. You can follow Dan. Dan, what's your Twitter?
It's Auction Guy Dan and Pay the Lady Laura.
So follow. John Luke sent a message. He says, "Thanks for the nice mention on the show. It's really a good interview conversation. Much appreciated." You know, John, I tell you, I've got my eye on you. I like to make interviews fun. I like to get the best out of guests. But you know, Dan, this is a little bit off subject, but I have found that I get the best out of guests when they don't think the camera is on, or they don't think that we're live. Yeah, then the true McCoy right now, comes out.
No, we're not on right now.
Great. Because I was afraid there for a second. I thought, oh my God, maybe we're on. No, I get it. It's like you're like a doctor, Robert. You're like a doctor.
I'd be a poor ass doctor, I'm telling you. No, I mean,
you know, you just, you know, like a psychologist, you know, you just talk to them, and they don't even think that you're about to call the law on them. They don't even think that. They feel very, confident, secure that, you're not going to say anything.
We were talking, Dan, before the show, we were talking about calling XYZ Company. It has two letters to the name.
Right.
And trust me, I would so do just that. That's me. For me, look. It's an oxymoron, Dan. For me, it is easier to raise money for other causes. It is easier for me to lend a hand to somebody else, especially when it comes to financial, to help them along, to do whatever they need to do. Whatever it is, we've raised thousands of dollars for the Occupy Wall Street group. That's one example. But, you know, for my own show, now that is something completely different, Dan. You know, it is very difficult to raise money, to stay on the air, to raise money, to keep going, to keep the syndicates going, and all this stuff. You know, and I'm like, oh my God, you know. So what gives? So Dan, am I losing it, or am I missing something? I think I've already lost it, but
I'm just trying to figure out what the hell you're talking about, Robert.
about success. You know, you can help other people.
Yeah.
And it's great to do that. But when it comes to helping yourself, does Dan ever say, I can't help myself in this situation?
You know, I certainly get to where I say I can't help somebody else. I mean, especially since I've sort of become, I'm kind of almost famous.
And you are famous. You are.
That's what they keep telling me. And I've got a lot of people around that just, I mean, you know, I have people show up after 25 years that I remember they owed me money 25 years ago. I don't know why they're calling me now. You know, some of them I'm really happy to hear from, but other ones I figure, you know, we didn't have that good a relationship. I don't know why you're calling me now. And I certainly have, you know, there's family dynamics around me that are, you know, kind of put a lot of pressure on us. And I just, you know, I just have to draw the line somewhere and say, okay, you got to go work it out. And I've tried to help you, but I can't keep enabling you. You're going to have to just step up, pull your boots up, and go figure this stuff out, because I can't help everybody. And so I just decided I do have to help myself. If you don't look out for yourself, Robert, nobody's going to. I swear, it just, you know, nobody's going to step up and help you. You're going to have to do it yourself.
That is true. Now, Joel, you've got another question, and we've got about 6 minutes before the top of the hour.
This is from the chat. A. Epperson asks, do you ever feel bad knowing you are auctioning off someone's belongings? Not saying it's wrong, but I'd imagine some have to be a bit heart-wrenching.
Yes. You know, the other day, I'm at an auction, and this gentleman shows up with his wife. He's 65 years old, real nice guy, and he's about to lose two units. He's got one he owes like $1,900 on, and he's got one he owes like $600 on. He's got the pink slip to his truck, and he's saying, I will sell this truck and get the money. And, you know, the management's saying, no, you know, we give you plenty of times. You've been here before, and we're not going down this road again. If you want to go to the auction, or if you want to buy one of these units out, you can buy the $1,900 one out, or you can buy the $600 one out and take the money into the auction. He didn't want to buy either one of them out. He wanted to take his chance at the auction. Well, he didn't get either one of them at the auction. And, you know, and then, you know, he was, you know, came up to me and he goes, I've got this pink slip. I will sell this truck and I'll give them whatever they want. I said, you just want to give them that pink slip to that truck for these two units? And he goes, well, no, I need it for work. Okay, that means you weren't really serious to begin with. You were just kind of lying to me. You're trying to, you know, bull me. And I get bulled all the time, so I can smell it coming from a mile away. So, you know, I take the guy's information. I tell him, look, I will talk to this buyer, and I will see if we can work out something for some of your stuff. Not the photographs and stuff, but he wanted others. He wanted everything, right? And, right. You know, he couldn't pay his bill now. I don't know why he needed more debt to pay for it. Long story short, I couldn't help this guy enough. He calls me up and he says, I've decided to go a different direction. And I said, what are you going to do? He goes, I'm just going to kill myself. And I'm on the phone with him. And I said, really? And he says, yes. And I just cussed him like a dog. I thought, you know what? I said, you've already made a mess this morning. You're going to make another one for your family now. You're very self-centered. You're not thinking about this stuff very clear. If you want to take your life for a bunch of crap, then that's what you should do, sir. And I just hung up on him. And I thought, oh, my God. Don't ever put me on the hotline for that kind of stuff, because I might not say the right thing, right? And he calls me back in about 20, 30 minutes. He goes, I'm really sorry, and I didn't mean that. I said, well, you can't be saying that to anybody. I said, I don't even know you, man. You call me from a blocked number, and, you know, I gave you my number. You don't give me your, but you do this stuff. He goes, I just want to try to work this out. I said, it's a little late now. I said, because after we hung up, I called the facility, and I said, if you show up over there, call the police, because you sounded like you weren't being safe to yourself or anybody else. And I said, and the guy that we were talking to that was going to get a hold of you, you can just forget about that too, because he doesn't want anything to do with you now either. So you just go back to the facility here in a few days, check for your personal stuff. And yes, I do feel bad, but what I do feel is that, you know, if one family loses stuff, then it's going to go help 10 families out there. It's going to help other people, because it gets kind of redistributed. And so that's the part that makes me feel better about it. I don't feel good about it. I don't want to sell anybody's stuff. But sometimes that's the best thing that can happen to them, because, you know, they're spending this money every month, or lack of, and they could be feeding their family with stuff, and they just don't always need the junk that's in storage, period.
Right.
Don't mean to seem cold.
There was a lady on another show, and I can't remember if it's on A&E. I love A&E. You know, I wish it had picked up the Robert Christian show, Dan. But I
you
can't
just
remember.
Up right now, they're listening. Trust me.
Maybe. Hey, I would love it, because you know what? I would so love to go across the board with everybody that is on A&E that has a show like your show, like John's show, and all these other shows, Ice Road Truckers and all these other ones, and interview one by one these people and let the viewers see and hear from these individual artists, these individual people, actors, participants, one-on-one, and you know that participation is everything, right? And let the viewers know a little bit more.
I think it's a great idea. I wouldn't even wait for A&E. If I was you, Robert, I'd just reach out to each and every one of them and do just like you did me. Just stalk me until I respond. That's it.
Hey, and I
see,
am not
now
a
you love being on the show, right? You love it.
I do love that. You're right, Joey. And I saw your Joey Shane TV before this one. You were doing your own stuff before, right?
Was I?
Okay, I'm wrong. I don't know. I thought I saw that.
You know, Dan, it's funny. Joey Shane, you're going to have to dig this up because I'm going to dig it up for you. Dan, Joey Shane, he has got a funny video.
That's probably what I saw.
And he was...
You're not the auctioneer.
No, he was working out. So what he had the thing going on, working out in front of his TV. I'm not going to give it away, but he's going to have to find that and post that and send that to you. You will laugh.
It was an exercise video. I'll put it that way. It was everyone who saw it was like, "Dude, I thought you were serious in the beginning. You were like so serious. He's like, you deserve an Oscar. You were an amazing actor, which I am, by the way. A&E listeners, no, I'm just kidding. But it was funny. A lot of people saw it, and people still come up to me today. And like, oh my God, you were in that video. Yeah, that was me. Yeah, it was great.
I just thought I saw the Shane TV somewhere. When I saw it earlier, I thought, you know, that really looks familiar to me. So I don't know, maybe. Anyway, you guys are great. You guys are a great duo, and it's fun doing. I'll do them anytime I can. It's fun to get together and talk to the fans, and it's shout out to all the fans, Hank, Jane, everybody. We appreciate you. Appreciate everything you do.
You bet. Sure. And John Luke in New York. I want to thank you,
John.
Once again. And
why
Barry,
why doesn't
get
John
Barry.
Come on here now? Why doesn't he just come? What's he doing?
I have no idea. John, like, hello.
You got to come on the show now.
He was actually on Twitter. Let me see if he's on Twitter.
Hello, it's the Robert Christian Show with Joey Shane.
Let me actually see if he tweets back. Folks, the Twitter, the neat thing about Twicker. That's what he calls it, George and Twicker. The neat thing about it is it's live. Like, as soon as somebody sends something, it's there, and it's gone. No taking back.
And it's safer than twerking.
Oh.
Robert!
Oh,
twerk.
No.
Twerk.
Dan.
That's almost a scary thought. Go ahead, Robert.
No. Hey, I've been mesmerized. Nobody wants to be watching me twerk, and I'm telling you that.
Fine.
Hey,
twerk.
He has a point, Joey.
Dan, do you twerk?
No, I'm not built for twerking. I'm built for rolling. I'm built for. I'm not built for twerking. I'm not built that way. And if I was, I don't think I'm wired that way. I'm just saying.
Can Laura twerk?
Laura has her own way of doing everything.
Oh,
so she's figured out how to do it.
I just can't even go there.
I don't know if it's a dance move.
I think is she coming on your show at some point? Don't you guys have a date or something?
With Laura. I would love to have her on. I'm telling you, I would so love to have Laura on.
Well, you'll have to ask her about twerking.
We'll have to talk about, we can talk about twerking, but hey, I'm not built for that either. Joey Shane, he saw it, and I was like, oh my God. I go, look here, Joey Shane. And he was just rolling. But listen, Dan, I don't know how long that you can stay with us tonight.
I mean, what are you guys going to do when I leave? Like, let's say I left right now. What would you do?
We're going to laugh at you and make fun of you.
Right?
We wouldn't. Yeah. Joey Shane, now you'd be nice. No, yeah. We'd be talking about some of the things that we learned from you, because, Dan, you're an educator.
You are, man.
You are an educator.
Thank you.
Like I say, hey, folks, we've got the best teacher. but he's got a poor student. That's me.
That's not true. Hey. Now, you guys are great communicators also, and really, you guys are great. And this Robert Christian Show is a great show, and I hope everybody tunes in and watches you guys, because you guys are great. You guys have good dynamics together, and the rock and roll hairdo, Joey, is great. That's what I'm talking about. Own it, baby, the way you do. And I just think you guys are great, no kidding. And I have a lot of fun. I had a lot of fun last time, and I've had a great time this time. I think I gotta go take care of something.
Yeah, he's gotta leave.
All right,
make fun of us and my green screen.
Listen, Dan, I'm about to give our the viewers about a minute or so and say your farewells or whatever that you'd like to tell them. And hey, that it's been great. I'm telling you. Yeah.
I appreciate it, man. You know, we might just step up the pump and say, hey, are you ready to go? Are you ready to go? I'm ready to go. Let's go. And it'll be 20, it'll be 30, 7, 7, half, it'll be 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 90, 90, 90, 90, 90, 90. I'm 100% sure that if you tune in and watch the Robert Christian Show, you're going to get educated, you're going to have a lot of fun, and you're going to be happy that you did. Thank you very much, and don't forget to pay the late.
All righty, Dana. Hey, it's been a great honor to have you on once again. And, of course, hey, you've always got a home.
Yeah. Thank you, and we'll do it again. If you guys are ever in Southern California, Joey, you need a cabin to go stay in? I got a couple of them. Just come on down. You guys got an invite anytime.
I'll be there.
That's right, awesome. There. Well, let's let Laura know that I'd love to get a hold of her and have her on. And, hey, I can get in her head a little bit, you know? Maybe she can sprout some.
That'd be the scariest thing you ever did.
Hey, I would love to talk to her. I really would. I think that should be great.
I don't think that you are ready for that, Robert.
Oh, I am more than ready, Dan.
All right. Adios, guys. Thank you very much. And thank you to all those Storage Wars fans out there. Tuesday nights, 9:30, 8:30 Central. We're going to be off for about 4 weeks after this next week, and then we're going to be back bigger than ever. And I promise you, I know they're talking about the end of the season this next week, but we're going to have plenty more shows of Storage Wars.
Just before you go, twerking plus auctioning. Maybe you can do that on one of the upcoming shows, as twerk and auctioneer at the same time.
I just don't see it working.
I don't either. Hey, it's a thought, right? But anyway, Dan, thanks so very much. And hey, tell Laura for us that we said hello.
I will. And goodbye, everybody. And thank you so much. Have a good one. God bless.
You too, Dan. All right, folks. Say that is Dan Dotson with A&E's Storage Wars. Wow, what a cool guy. Joey
Fabulous
Shane.
Fabulous interview. That was awesome. I love it when people come on like that. I love it.
Now, let me find. Oh, yes. Here is your cam. Yeah, you know what? I was really, really looking forward to Dan coming on. I got to fix your screen. You're off-colored.
Yeah, I mean, that's nothing unusual. I'm always off color.
Okay, now, you know what? You're kind of, I've got like half of your face.
Can we do this? Can we take our hard break? And, because I've got to go piss bad.
Yeah, we can do that. Hey, folks, stick around. This is the Robert Christian Show live in Seattle. And once again, I want to thank Dan Dotson and Laura, his wife. Pretty lady.
Yeah.
Don't forget to pay the lady.
And
if you guys are nice to us, really, I might actually talk Joy Shane into doing his auctioneer for you all over again. Anyway, hey, folks, hang in there, folks, and we'll be back, ladies and gentlemen, right after this brief little interlude. You got it. All right, we'll be back, folks. All right, ladies and gentlemen, hey, we are back with the Robert Christian Show, and hey, I want to thank everybody for tuning in today for our special interview, you bet, with Dan Dotson. You know, it's been a good show, I think. You know, we need to have more shows, Joey Shane, like that, don't you think?
Yes, I do. I do believe it. I think we need to do more shows like this. It's always fun just to sit back and I don't know. One of the things I like about the Robert Christian Show is it's not like, you know, an interview, like where people, you know, you sit down and someone's reading from it. Now tell me, what was it like when you know, that kind of stuff. It's just like a conversation. You get to know, like, the person. Like, he is such a genuine, you know, humble guy. He's funny. Oh my God, he's like the funniest guest I've ever had. I loved it. I'd love to do more interviews like that in the future.
You know, I've got to say that, well, of course, that was the second time that we had that we were honored, very blessed, actually, to have Dan Dotson on. And I would so do it again. But, you know, like I said there at the end, I would so love, Joey, to get in, really, of all groups, like with A&E, for an example. I really would. Trust me, and do interviews with some with a lot of these other actors, these other participants on some of these other shows. Storage Wars is just one of them. The Storage War in New York, John Luke and those that he works with, you know, the same thing. You know, even having what is her name? The chef. Good grief, she's from South Georgia.
Paula Deen.
Even have Paula Deen on as a guest. You know, the sky's the limit, Joey, as to what we can do.
I'm going to tell you, I had this idea for a show, and I'm going to put this out there if anybody's paying attention and would like to take me up on the idea. You can contact me at joeyshane@robertchristianshow.com. But it's my idea for a show, so don't be out there stealing my stuff, people. But here's my idea. Around the world in 80 gays. Having a gay guy going around the world, traveling to different locations. You know, and it would just be hilarious, I think. I think it would be a great idea. I don't know.
John Lucas.
Maybe I'm full of crap. I don't know. But I think it's a great idea. If some of the shows I've seen on TV can be on TV, my idea can be on TV.
Hey, absolutely. Speaking of John Luke, he says, liked the Dotson interview. You should go on there and drum up Storage Wars at A&E.com. You know, look, folks, it's sort of funny, but it's sort of sad, Joy, because I've had people that have told me straight up, not a question, well, nobody likes you. It makes me want to sit there.
That's why you got me.
Yeah, okay. you know, and they're like, well, nobody likes you. What do I want to hang out with you for? But, you know, we have been blessed to get some of the most intelligent people to interview and to have on the shows in the last year than ever before, Joy.
Yeah, I'm getting a lot of comments on the show, too. It was awesome. Awesome. Oh my God, wow. It was great. I feel like squealing. Just went to the grocery store. Oh, that's a personal message. Never mind. But yeah, people seem to like the show, so awesome.
Okay. Hey, folks, hang on just a minute. If you can, of course, everybody can. Shh. Don't tell nobody. I've got to get screens set up and stuff. Okay. And then, Joy, that way I can be sitting right there side by side with Joy Shane. If y'all can imagine that. But, folks, I also want to tell you a little bit about Mr. Joy Shane. Lord. Just a little bit. Hey, don't oh Lord me. Folks, hey, he does fantastic work here on for the show. He does. And I am forever grateful for it. When I have needed a confidant, when I have needed somebody that that would be there to help the situation, the show, to enlighten everybody, to give everybody, you know, it's Joey, he never fails to amaze me. And once again, hey, Joy, I am grateful.
Well, thank you, sir, and I'm grateful for this amazing opportunity that you gave me to come on your show and be your co-host and run my mouth and interview all these amazing people that's been on the show and some not so amazing and some that are just downright delusional. But it's fun. It's been a trip. I can't believe it's been 8 months. I mean, it really seems like it was just like last week I sent you that Facebook message. You know, I don't even remember what the first one was. Are you live now or something? And you were like, yes. And I was like, cool. And yeah, it's been an amazing, amazing journey. I sound like I'm like dying or something, but I'm not. I'm not leaving or anything. It's just, you know.
No,
it's been amazing.
Joy, you have helped to make it an amazing place. And Andrew, I love him dearly. Folks that want to know who Andrew is, who the hell is Andrew? Andrew is our tech guy. He's a good friend. He really is a good confidant. I've been able to share a lot of things with Andrew over the last 3 years or so. And he has been very instrumental.
Yeah.
And Joy, you know, this is what I think that we need to do. Is have a look back in memory lane just a little bit. Because, you know, like I told Dan on the show, I don't think that it's right for people to become all rich and famous. It's not politically correct for people to become well known in the least. And not ever look back and thank those that have helped them along their journey.
Right.
You know, I can't say that I'm rich. God only knows I'm the furthest thing from it. I can't say, you know, trust me. I can't say that I'm famous. I can't. But what I can say is that my background in media has come in handy in this, really, in this platform, Joy, and all of those folks that have helped in the past. You know, I forever am going to remember them.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, Joy, at one time in my life, speaking of New York, there was a time in my life, and I'm serious, when I was homeless in New York City, sleeping in Grand Central Station, in the front, and I've never said this on the air, I don't think, but I slept in front of a Federal Express shipping place that was right there in Grand Central, eating out of garbage dumpsters just to survive. It was a teetotal disastrous mess.
Right.
And it was one man, Maddie, I'll never forget him, that literally saved my life. You know, Joy, it's people like that, though, that I look at, that I remember, and say, you know what, if it wasn't for them. And then I look at Steve, my partner, and I, you know, look, he may not have saved my life, but he sure as heck saved my heart from a lot of heartache.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Joey, what about you? You know, there have been people that have helped to mold you, and being very creative in your own life.
Yeah, yeah.
How has that worked out for you? Have you remembered anything that maybe somebody said to you a long time ago, maybe, that helped to mold you into the person that you are today?
Gosh, there's been so many, you know, influential people in my life. I think probably the person who had the most impact on my life is my mom. I haven't always been this nice, funny, charming, good-looking, sexy, attractive, mouth-watering, delicious hunk of a man that you see before you now. You know, there was a point in time in my life where things kind of just fell apart, you know, and I had a really bad decade. And I'm not joking. It was the worst 10 years of my life. And I really felt like during that time that I was crawling through hell on my knees on a path of broken glass. I mean, it was horrific that time of my life. And my mom was always there, always. She never gave up on me. She always knew that eventually I'd straighten my act up and, you know, become a better person, be a better man. And she never gave up on me. So that's probably one of the best lessons that I've ever learned in life is, you know, no matter how bad someone seems at the time, you know, if you love them and you see something in them, don't give up on them, you know, which in turn told me, you know, don't give up on your dreams, you know, stick with stuff, finish it out, you know. So she was very influential in my life. My grandfather was a huge influence in my life. He was an amazing man. I think about him every day. There's not a day that goes by that I don't think about my grandfather or something he said or this ring that he had that I wanted so bad, but because of family issues, he had to be buried with it. But, you know, I think about my grandpa all the time. He was influential in my life too. So,
you know, I want to let's talk about Dan for a minute. Dan, love okay. you. I do. I think it's great. I can't say that Dan is a hero, but he is a good, very good teacher.
Yeah.
And in his own way, folks, I've talked to him total of like 4 times. Total. But you know, even with Dan, you know, he presents a challenge to make more out of than what is. To look at things objectively, to look at things as if they are and say, you know what? So what? Things could be better? Lovely. Let's press on. But things could be way worse. I've learned some things from him.
Right.
Joy, I've learned an awful lot from you too. You know what he's doing, folks? Hey, we're going to snoop into the life of Joy Shane.
You want to know what I'm doing right now?
Yeah, what are you doing? He's got his baby. Hey, that is the a special co-host right there. His poor baby.
Best buddy. The best buddy in the whole world. Right here.
Joy Shane has been recreating, building his own tent to go camping, and he's planning on going canoeing? Not canoeing.
Kayaking.
What's the difference? He's going to do this tomorrow. Yes?
Sunday.
I was going to do the same thing. Okay, and for those that missed earlier in the show, you guys missed it, I'm telling you, because Joy Shane and I, we got our auctioneer going on.
We did.
And you know, I had to do it that way. And I so wanted to tell Dan to begin with. Oh, guess what? We have a surprise thing for him. But I didn't. I kind of waited. And you know what, Joy? I mentioned the Robert Christian Show coffee cup. Look, folks, look.
Yeah, I see that. I have one as well. Oh, wait, no. I don't have a Robert Christian Show coffee mug.
Well, we're going to fix you up. We are. I was talking to Dan about it. And he goes, I held it up, and he goes, good God. He goes, you either have really small hands or that is a huge cup. And I said, it's like 16 ounces. It's a big boy mug. And I told him, I said, I would love to send him one of those. So he can auction it off. and give the proceeds to his favorite charity.
Right.
And he said he would be all for it. He really would. And then we started talking about a car company with two letters. So hey, I might actually contact this place. I mean, I don't know. You know, look, I might be a little guy, but I try to have a voice of some kind.
Right.
So what kind of shenanigans, Joey Shane, are you planning on getting into over this weekend in that whitewater rapids that you're planning on going down?
Oh, Lord, you know nothing, man. It's kayaking. It sort of looks like a canoe, but it's a kayak. There's a difference. And the kayak's kind of flat-bottomed, where a canoe's got a, you know, and you're more able to tip over in a canoe than you are a kayak. But anyway, me and one of my really, really good friends and her girlfriend are going kayaking, and then afterwards we're going back to her girlfriend's house and we're having a cookout, and I'm going to stuff my face. And tomorrow I'm hopefully going to be 90% done with my homemade tent. So, yeah, really excited.
Well, for those that want a brief update, Joy, you went camping last weekend. And I brought it up, you know, and I said this. As much as he's shaking his head. I said this, look, there's a lot of things that people carry with them through life. And some things they don't need to carry with them.
Yeah.
Because it's useless. And so, you know, Joy, I was sort of mesmerized, I guess, by what happened with you on that trip, and thinking, you know what, that would really be an interesting show idea to talk about, because there are so many people that go through life dumbfounded, thinking that they need every single thing.
Yeah.
And in essence, they don't need all of that to exist, to survive.
Right.
But Joy, hey, you went prepared.
Yeah, I mean, you know, you go camping, and I should say, like, when I used to go camping, you know, a lot by myself, it was pretty much just, you know, me, a small tent, and a fishing pole, some, you know, food, you know, a little bit of food, whatever, and you know, off into the woods I'd go, and I'd find a spot somewhere on a riverbank or whatever, and I'd set up my little camp, and, you know, you'd use the bathroom in the woods, and, you know, you do everything in the woods, you know? So I decided to take, Lord, I hope she's not listening, but I decided to take my best friend and her two children camping, and all that week she was saying, oh, I'm going to take this, and I'm going to take that, and I'm going to take... And I kept saying, you know, you got to think, because we have to take all this stuff into the woods. We have to bring all this stuff out of the woods. And because of their limited camping experience, they had said they'd been camping before, and I later found out that it was RV camping, which is not camping. That's RVing. It's not camping. But... You know, I was like, you know, just remember, you know, we're going to a campsite that's got a bathroom facility. It had showers, you know, little campsites along this beautiful lake in the mountains of North Carolina. It was gorgeous. And more things kept getting added to this, you know, camping trip. And I had a bag with, you know, literally a little shopping bag with a pair of underwear and some extra socks in it. And that was it. And, you know, I had a couple of cookwares. Anyway, just basic things I took with me. And there was 15 bags of stuff that she brought with her. And it was ridiculous. I mean, you don't need 24 sodas when you go camping. I mean, those are heavy. And when you're carrying them, they're very heavy. So, you know... a lot of uncalled for things.
I got to tell you, Joy, talking about extra baggage, you know, we flew a couple of years ago down to Disneyland from Seattle.
Yes.
But we called the airline because we found out how much the sodas were at Disney. And so we thought, oh, okay. So we called the airline and we said, hey, listen, we want to bring a case of soda with us down there. Is this okay? Put it in our luggage. And you know what? They actually let us put it in our luggage, Joy.
Wow. Can't do that now.
No. But it all made it down there, and we saved a little. Hey, folks, I want to remind everybody, let's look ahead on our calendars a little bit. The 29th, which is this upcoming Tuesday, Brandon is going to be, he's a good, fun-loving guy. He is a chef. He is going to be going live on the Robert Christian Show, folks, and we're going to be talking about diet, the American diet. And oh boy, do we ever have something to learn from that.
Yes, absolutely.
Oh my gosh. I mean, a lot of people are just eating stuff, Joy, that is so totally unhealthy for them. But do we keep doing it? Yes. We'll find out why.
There's a certain restaurant, I'm not going to say because I don't want to get sued or murdered, but there's a certain restaurant that I refuse, well, there's two that I refuse to eat at, but there's one now that I absolutely, I don't even want to go through the drive-thru. I don't even want to go near it. I avoid it at all costs because the stuff that I found out was in their food would make you vomit. It would, and you know, I've ate it before and I thought, oh my God. You know, and I'm glad that we're getting a chef on the show because it allows me the opportunity to ask a lot of dietary questions that, you know, I have. Like, one, as an example, how can a Dorito be bad for you if it tastes as good as it does? That just doesn't make any sense.
Right. Exactly. He would be a good one to ask.
So I'm wanting to find out what's wrong with Doritos because there can't be anything wrong with a Dorito.
Nothing. No offense to Doritos. I like them too.
I love Doritos.
You know what? I think it's Doritos, isn't it? You can't just buy. You know what? Speaking of Doritos, they had a Super Bowl ad, and I thought it was funny. This little kid got in this cardboard box, and his neighbor come along and started hitting the side of the box with his foot, or the little kid did. He got out of the box and was talking to his neighbor, and his neighbor just put a whole bag of Doritos down through this thing because the little kid said, put it down. I thought that was funny. Anyway, he's going to be on next Tuesday. Brandon is.
It was a time machine, Robert.
Yes, that's it. Hey, on the 2nd of May, oh boy, we have guests coming in May.
Lord, do we ever.
Miss Rose, to begin with, going to be with us for a full 2-hour interview on May the 2nd.
Full 2 hours.
She is a transgendered woman and very kind, very polite. She was on the show before, and we're going to be bringing her back. Fantastic. It is.
We had a huge response for her being on the show.
Oh my gosh, you're not kidding. Huge response.
That her appearance on the show is actually what prompted May being called Transition Month.
Yes.
People don't understand. This whole month coming up stemmed from one show. 1 hour. Of one show. Amazing show.
And then on the 6th, who is this? Malaya, is that how you say that?
Yeah. Malaya Chanel Inman.
Okay. Male to female. Going to be joining us.
Yeah.
Oh.
Who's also, if I might add, who is North Carolina's reigning Miss Trans Carolina pageant winner. So.
Awesome.
Celebrity in the trans community here in North Carolina.
And, ladies and gentlemen, it gets better than that.
It does.
if you can imagine, you know, okay, a husband, a son, mm-hmm. a mother, and a wife, and a daughter are going to be coming live on the show as well. That's just a little teaser. For those that want a little that's a little teaser. And then we have Joey Shane's birthday bash. Hey, we got to figure something out to do with Joey Shane's birthday.
I got this thing that I'm working on, and I'm ready to share it with my beloved audience and Robert.
See, I'm last. See there?
It's transition month, right?
Yeah.
Right? The whole month of May, my birth month, is transition month. So, what better month to begin my transition process than that day, my birthday, my actual day I was born on? We're having a show on that day, 23rd of May. I'm going to take my clothes off on that show and reveal to the world me and my transition, where I'm going in life. It's going to be an amazing, amazing spiritual cleansing for me.
At least that's what he has plans on.
I'll add this and then I'll shut up, because I have body image issues, right? I have like huge body image issues. I got a little gut. I'm kind of skinny, you know. So I'm just going to reveal it. I'm just going to put it all out there and be like, this is me. Now that everyone's seen me, it's time to transition into the muscular Hulk of a beast of a man that I want to become.
We need, maybe on the 23rd, Joy Shane, we'll have a twerk off.
That would be awesome.
Listen to the language, the verbiage, a twerk off. That might be funny. Oh, God. Okay, anyway, back to the calendar, Joy.
Oh, yeah, that is a calendar.
The 27th, Pamela Raintree.
Yes.
Folks, she made the national news. Because what she did was she went before the city council in her local town near Shreveport, Louisiana. I think it was Bossier City, right outside of Shreveport. And she's got up there and she was making her case. But she went prepared with a rock, with a stone. And she held it out in her hand and she said, "If you want to throw the stone at me, here it is."
Yeah.
And she is transition month. So, hey, that's going to be good. And then we have Mischief going to be joining us at 4 p.m. that day. See, the calendar's getting filled. In the month of June, do I have anything? Yeah, we have something going on in July, too. But in the month of June, June is even getting filled up. Listen to this. Trebos, he is an Occupy Wall Street broadcaster. I'll be going live with him on Friday, the 6th of June, and that will actually be the last interview that I would have, interview with anyone from the Occupy Wall Street group.
That's it.
He will be it. So I'm grateful that he decided finally to go live on a live show, but that will be it, because, you know, We have to focus, and there is a reason for all of this, folks, because we are winding up and getting ready for July, because that is going to be absolutely so key. And then we have David Bryant, right?
Yes.
He is a gay author coming on Friday the 13th in June.
Yes.
Tell everybody a little bit about David.
Well, David is, as you said, he is an author. He also happens to be homosexual, and he'll be joining us to discuss his new book. It's called 15, and it's due out, the end of May, I believe, possibly the 1st of June. It's a funny book. It's gay fiction. It's hilarious. I have the what is it called? The description of the book, but I just don't have it in front of me right now.
Right.
So supposedly what I can remember from it is it was originally a fan fiction book, you know, where people who are fans of a certain like musical group or a TV show or something, and they write their own stories, and sometimes these stories are so good they're published. Well, this is the first in a series of three books that he's writing. He sent me the first 40 pages. Pretty good stuff. Enjoy reading it. It was funny. A lot of it was funny. There's a lot of kinky stuff in there too. But it should be an entertaining show. I just want to put this out there as, you know, for our regular viewers. David is hearing impaired. He wears a hearing aid. And anyone who ever does Skype knows the difficulties with Skype. So what we'll be doing is we'll be typing our questions to him via Skype, but then we will repeat them to our viewers and podcast listeners. So there may be a tiny delay between question and response. So I just want to put that out there. But we don't discriminate on the Robert Christian Show. So.
And speaking of birthdays, though, Joy, my birthday is also a show day. In the month of June, let's see, we also have coming up on June the 27th, my dear friend Roger Winters.
And love that guy.
He's an educator. He worked for the city of Seattle, Washington. He's also a college professor.
Right.
And we're going to be talking about the anniversary of Stonewall.
That'll be a great show.
Powerful. And then, ladies and gentlemen, woohoo, vacation time the first week in July. Yours truly, Mawa. You know where I'm going to go for my vacation?
Where?
Well, I'll tell you. I'm going to go in the living room. I'm going to have my cup of coffee. I'm going to sit in the living room with the dog, with my partner Stevie. Sit back, relax, and that's it. You know, we were talking with for those that missed it, and you all really missed a good show. You did. The last time that Dr. Simon Adkins was on, because we were talking about the Twicker. We're talking about the Twickers. We're talking about Facebook. And can you actually get off of it? And would you miss it in a day, or would you miss it in a week or a month or a year? I think a lot of people say yes because they get so addicted to it.
A lot of people's head would explode if that. Did you hear about the woman who fell in the hole and was more worried about getting her phone back than she was getting out of the hole?
No.
Yeah, it was a news story.
Really?
I thought, really? That's what we've evolved to? Is our phones are more important than us?
Oh, mercy. You know, I would be like, oh my gosh. You know what? People are like that, Joy, and I don't get it. You know,
I don't either.
You know, they would much rather... oh, come on. You know, it brings me back, Joy, to the issue with the fishing trip. It really does. How much stuff do you really and truly, really, really need?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, good God. You know, no offense to people, but look. You know, I like to be prepared, but I like to have exactly what I need in my preparations, and not any more than that. And Joy... With the interview tonight with Dan, I think he's a great guy.
But, funny. Oh, my God. So funny.
yeah, he is. He got a great sense of humor. But, you know, I wanted to wing it. I didn't send you a list of questions, and I did that deliberately.
And I didn't have a list of questions like I did for other guests.
Right. No. And the reason, you know, you were talking. Who was it? Was it Andrew or was it you that was talking about scripting? Or what is the Storage Wars? Is it scripted?
Yeah, I asked the question, is storage worth scripting? Because, you know, there's like, I don't know if this is true or not, but there's a controversy about Duck Dynasty being scripted. It's a completely scripted show.
Yes.
So I just wanted to ask, you know, is it like, you know, Storage Wars like other shows that are supposed to be reality shows but are actually scripted?
Absolutely. And you know, no. So the Robert Christian Show, are we scripted? No, of course not.
Sometimes we follow a list of questions, or we have questions ahead of time for guests, but no, everything, I mean, if you can't tell, I mean, come on. We are not scripted.
You know, Dan was talking about Laura, and you know, I would love to interview Laura, his wife. Absolutely. Yeah, in a heartbeat. John Luke in New York, he's another one. Barry Weiss, I'd love to, you know, there's a lot of people that I want to, that I would love to have an interview with, Joey. And I think that eventually we can.
I want to do my show around the world in 80 gays. I want to be the gay guy that goes on all these adventures all over the world.
You know what? There is a, no, I'm thinking about the coffee bean. Show. I can't remember if it's on A&E or if it's on History. But this guy, he is paid to travel the world looking for the very best coffee beans that there is.
Uh-huh.
Have you seen that?
No.
I can't remember the name of it, but it's something about you know, getting the best cup of Joe or I can't remember the name of it.
Yeah.
Anyway, it's been a good show tonight, Joey.
It has, sir. It has.
A lot of ground has definitely been covered.
Yeah, I'd have to agree with you. It's and it's just, it's really important to me that when we have guests on the show that we learn about the guests, not just what they're doing and their show and, you know, things that are happening, but the person. That's what I like. Is that a show called Dangerous Grounds?
Yeah. That's it. Yep.
Okay. I Googled it. No, awesome. I'm sorry. I goggled it.
He's got the goggles.
I got the goggles.
Yeah, it's a great show. They were in Tibet. I think it was Tibet, over there, looking, and it was a very small village, way out in the middle of nowhere. I mean, through the mountain passes and the valleys. I mean, it was crazy to get there to find the perfect bean.
Yeah.
Totally amazing show. But you
just
know, folks,
give me a cup up, and I'll be fine. I ain't giving no free damn advertising no more.
No.
Pay for their coffee to be advertised, then needs to send us some money.
I'm telling you, you know, it costs money, as you know, Joey, to run a show, to do a show, and to do it right. It takes money to operate. It takes money to do what you need. And you know, I know, you know. Hey, I said it before we actually went live. We're talking about your background and your green screen, and I want to end up getting you a much better one, but I can't do it yet. Until,
well, I'm damned determined. I'm going to build a damn green screen. If it kills me, I'm going to get it right. This one's, you know, it's all right, but it's bending and warping and all kinds of things.
You know, I was talking to Dan during the show, and I brought the point. I said, you know what, Joey, Shane, and I, we talk a lot during the week. It's like daily.
Yeah.
At least once a day.
Two times a day.
Yep. Specifically about the show or elements about the show or guests or planning, scheduling, just different things. And, you know, folks, I mean it. We do. There is an awful lot, but Joey, I think it's important that we are on the same page, actually.
I'll agree with that to a certain extent, but I prefer where you come from with your point of views and where I come from with my point of views and finding that middle ground like we often do. because I think that's what's missing in the world is, you know, everyone's like, oh, my way is the only way, it's the right way, da 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 da, and everybody else, no, 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 my way is the right way, it's the only way. And there's no middle ground found. I hate the word compromise because it makes me believe that I would have to compromise my beliefs. You know, so, but there has to be some type of healthy middle ground.
Well, I don't want anybody to compromise their beliefs at all. I don't think that that's good. I think that people need to be who that they are. We are who that we are for a reason. I mean, not everybody can be Dan Dotson or Laura. Not everybody can be Robert Christian or Joey Shane. But everybody has a story to tell. Everybody has something to say that that they can share with the world, and sit back with their shoulders back and say, you know what, I'm glad, I'm very proud that I did just that.
Yeah, it's like we don't agree on everything, Robert, but that's what makes us human. You know, you're not a carbon copy of me, and I'm not a carbon copy of you, and we're going to differ on things, but the things that we differ on, you know, are sometimes the things that bring us closer together. And like Dan had said, you know, we have a great camaraderie, and, you know, we play off each other a lot, and, you know, I think that comes from our differences, our different backgrounds,
it's called chemistry.
Yeah, I'm a little bit country, you're a little bit rock and roll.
Oh, the hell you say. You know, but I mean, folks, it's the truth, and I've said, Joy, for at least 3 years in this media, in this platform, that I needed a co-host, and I always said, Andrew, I love you, Andrew, he remembers that. I'd say, look, we need a co-host around here. It's what I need. Somebody to bounce ideas off of, somebody to bounce things back and forth. And when you found, God, I don't know how you did that, but when you found us on YouTube, love YouTube, we're still actually on the air there for a few more minutes. But when you found us on YouTube, I was amazed. I was like, wow, I want to meet this guy. I want to talk to him. There's something kind of interesting about him, and I'm glad that I followed my instinct.
You poor guy, you were looking for a co-host and found me.
Yeah, I did. Hey, I must say, but you know, Joy, you're part of what makes the show what it is and a fun place. You know, is it a new show? Is it a comedy? I don't know. Can it be? Yeah. Is it educational? Perhaps. Depends on who you ask.
And what you're trying to get educated on.
Yeah, I mean, we can educate you on a lot of things.
Andrew said in the chat, he said, I was a co-host for some time. Thank God Joey showed up to get the place gay.
Andrew, what can I say? Andrew, I can't believe you said that.
I can.
But you know what? Actually, I was talking to Andrew for probably a year and a half. And he kept saying, look, you got to find your niche. Okay, Andrew, fine. Find your niche. Okay, fine, Andrew. He kept saying that. And said, "What? You know what? You need to do something in the LGBT community. And focus on that a bit." And I was like, okay, Andrew, whatever. Okay, Andrew. He remembers, and now look at where we are. Look at who we have. Hey, and I even said to you, Joey, there ain't nothing wrong with having a co-host that's a little eye candy, okay?
Well, let me know when you find that co-host.
I'm a-looking at her. I mean, at him.
Oh, the sweet things you say. What do you want?
$1 million, a good suitcase, and a really fast car. That'll work.
That's funny.
Hey, that's what Matt used to always say. So, hey, folks, we want to know what is on your mind always. Every hour of it. Very funny, Andrew. We'd like to know what is on your mind. And if you have a show idea, let us know. Visit us on the web at robertchristianshow.com. Joey Shane has a bio page on there. Believe that.
Yeah, I do. I need to put my email address on there. I didn't do that, so I need to put my email address on there.
That's in coding. I can do that. Anyway,
we'll talk about it later. Can I take just a second? Just 1 second?
Uh-uh.
Just one little tiny minute. I don't do this often, but whatever your spiritual preference is, or if you don't have a spiritual preference and you believe in good vibes and sending energy out to people or whatever it is, could you guys please do your ritual thing for our tech guy Andrew? He's been kind of sick lately and he could use the good vibes and positive energy coming his way. So guys, just take just a moment, you know, good thoughts, click your heels together 3 times, whatever.
And say, there ain't nobody like Andrew.
No, nobody.
You know, so yes, absolutely. I agree, Joy. I totally agree. And this is brought to you by. But you know, I think Andrew, he has been a keeper. He's been a very key element on the show. And you know, I don't want to lose Andrew's friendship. I don't want to lose him as a tech guy at all. I want to preserve him. Preserve a good, solid friendship with him. I think that's excellent. You know, I've got to say though, I've never run into anybody quite like Andrew at all. And I do respect him. Enjoy the same thing with you. I never met anybody quite like you.
Never will.
Well, hey, I try. But every now and then, yeah, I can get my nose out of the corner every now and then, for what it's worth. Yeah, Andrew says, better pay up then. Just kidding. Yeah, you know, I'm telling you, I so would. You know, if we were just suddenly discovered, right?
Yeah.
And I say that in a good way. But if we were suddenly trust me, I would so be all over it.
But in the meantime, until we're discovered, I need some money.
He has his coin thing. You got a coin jar. Hey, we've got one in the other room, and I think it's got about $5 in it.
It's a pickle jar. I love pickles. Oh, it don't smell like pickles, though. It smells like ass and feet.
Now I've seen everything, Joey. All right, folks. Anyway, listen, visit us on the web, robertchristianshow.com. We are live Tuesdays and Fridays. Don't forget, however, in July, we are planning on adding 3 shows to our weekly lineup. We're not sure just yet when the third show or third date would be, but we're looking into it. We're seeing what we can do. With that,
I want to do a Robert Christian.
Say again.
Can't. I want to do a Robert Christian show after dark. I want to do an after dark show, and you know what I mean by after dark.
All right, folks. Hey, this is the Robert Christian show. So long for now, folks. We'll see you this upcoming Tuesday right here. Joey Shane, don't go too far. Love you all. Thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed the show.